Jan Mana Jungila,
Jan Mana Jungila,
Unasawa Unidad. So welcome everybody to our press conference today. I want to thank the media for coming out today. My name is Terry Ballin. I'm the director of the Filipino Community Center, which is a proud member of the San Francisco Immigrant Legal and Education Network.
And my name is Cynthia, and I'm with Causa Justa, also a proud member of the network. And
we want to thank everyone for coming today. So good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for coming to Immigrant Family Day. Every year for the last 7 years, the San Francisco Immigrant Legal and Education Network, SF Island, comes together with our clients and members for a day of civic engagement. Today is our 8th Immigrant Family Day. SF Island is a collaboration of 13 community-based organizations providing free immigrant legal services and community education to low-income immigrants citywide. Since 2006, we have served over 20,000 immigrants with our services.
Today we have a lot to celebrate. We are in the 8th year of providing this very much needed services to the immigrant community. And we're also today releasing the results of our community-based project, the San Francisco Immigrant Integration Project. This project was we'll hear a lot more about it, but this project was a beautiful collaboration of all the network agencies to really talk about what our communities need to not only survive but also thrive. And we're also here to celebrate today, as we'll hear shortly from our Board of Supervisors, that April will be officially designated as Immigrant Family Day, Immigrant Family Month in San Francisco. Give it up.
We also want to thank one of our funders in the city of San Francisco, the Mayor's Office of Housing and Community Development, for their support. But in particular today, we want to thank Supervisor David Campos. Supervisor Campos. He has been a long-time supporter of SF Island and immigrant rights. His office really led the effort to have April this month designated as Immigrant Family Month to recognize the contributions of all of our immigrant families and communities. And can we get another round of applause for Supervisor David Campos? And if you want to just invite him up to say a few words, as well as any other supervisors today. So thank you, Supervisor Campos.
Thank you, Terry. Thank you, everyone. How's everyone doing today? So my name is David Campos, and I am proud to not only represent District 9 on the Board of Supervisors, but to stand here as someone who is proud to by thanking SF Island for the amazing work that they do. And I want to acknowledge the 13 organizations that make up this incredible group. The African Advocacy Network, the Arab Resource and Organizing Center, Asian Americans Advancing Justice, the Asian Law Caucus, the Asian Pacific Islander Legal Outreach, the Central American Resource Center, Chinese for Affirmative Action, Casa Justa, Dolores Street Community Services, the Filipino Community Center, La Raza Centro Legal, La Raza Community Resource Center, Mujeres Unidas y Activas, and people organizing to demand environmental and economic rights for them. And I also want to acknowledge in the audience, we see Tim Paulson, who's the executive director of the San Francisco Labor Council. We've always had the support from our labor partner. But today I'm here to announce that we will be voting on a resolution at the Board of Supervisors, and I want to thank the following co-sponsors of that resolution: Supervisor Avalo, Supervisor Yi, Supervisor Kim, Supervisor Tang, and Supervisor Chu. This is a resolution that today will be declaring the month of April in San Francisco as Immigrant Family Month here in the City and County of San Francisco.
Hoy estaremos votando en una resolución que establecerá el mes de abril en la ciudad de San Francisco como el mes de las familias inmigrantes en San Francisco.
Just to give give you a few facts about San Francisco. 36% of San Francisco's population is foreign-born, and I'm proud to be one of the 36% that is included in that. 45% of San Francisco's households, almost half, speak a language other than English at home. One in 14 children in San Francisco is an immigrant, one in 14. And 54% of San Francisco's children have at least one parent who is immigrant. So we are a city of immigrants. Immigrants have helped to build San Francisco. Immigrants have been a part of the prosperity that we have seen throughout the city. And we have always been a city that protects the dignity, the humanity of immigrants, irrespective of their immigration status. We are proud to be a sanctuary city, and we believe that San Francisco will always be the leader when it comes to this country in terms of protecting the rights of immigrants. So today I am proud to be introducing this resolution, and we ask for unanimous support at the Board of Supervisors so that we send a very clear message that we have always been, we continue to be, and we will always be pro-immigrant in San Francisco. Thank you so much.
Being Immigrant Family Month. So next up, I want to bring up Supervisor Norman Yee from District 7.
I'm proud to be a co-sponsor of the resolution to declare April Immigration Family Month in San Francisco. San Francisco is rich in culture, diversity, language, ideas, and character because it's built upon the contribution of immigrants who decided to migrate here, to work here, to raise their families here, and to build history here. As a son of an immigrant father, I know firsthand sacrifices and that my parents made to forge the life of opportunities for me and my sister and my brothers. So it wasn't easy, and at the time there weren't many resources or protections for people like my family. This is why the work you do is so important. And I have been dedicated to serving immigrant families for more than 35 years in the nonprofit world. I want to commend the organizations that are here today who work tirelessly to protect the dignity of immigrants and to empower our community members here in San Francisco. Because of your advocacy, our city now has a history of supporting working immigrant families through our public school system, children's and family services, the language access ordinance, Health in San Francisco, and most recently, the passage of Due Process for All. While immigration reform continues to be a struggle in Congress, we here in San Francisco have already taken a strong stance that we are a sanctuary city that not only welcomes immigrant families to live and thrive here, but one that honors them. Thank you very much. Happy Immigration Family Month.
Thank you, Supervisor Yee. Okay, so thank you to those supervisors who could join us today. We want to thank especially all of the community members who are here today. This is a beautiful day in San Francisco, and it's that much more beautiful with all of us here today at City Hall raising our voices up together. So thank you all. And give yourselves a round of applause.
And next up, we'd like to invite Professor Bill Hing to come and share a few words with us. Professor Hing is a professor at USF and has also been a longtime supporter of immigrant rights, of the Due Process for All Ordinance, of Due Process for Youth. And so we'd like to thank him for all his contributions to the immigrant community, and we'd also like to invite him to speak to us today about, to share a few words with us. Thank you.
First of all, on behalf of the San Francisco Immigrant Rights Commission, I want to welcome all of you and point out that the Immigrant Rights Commission last night passed a resolution supporting the Board of Supervisors' resolution to declare April a month of immigrants. And also, we also passed a resolution supporting SF Island's report on immigrant integration. So we want to applaud you for all of that. There are other members of the commission here that I want to point out. The Vice Chair, Celine Tonelli, the two other members, Kathy Cole, and one other member who I know all of you know very well, Melba Maldonado is here. I may be missing somebody else. And also staff director of the Office of Civic Engagement, Adrian Pond, who's in the back there. So I want to point out that in San Francisco, we have a lot to teach San Francisco. But we can also learn from what San Francisco has done, because we know that most Americans support immigrants. It's just that there's a small local minority who dominate the conversation in the United States. So I have an assignment for you as a professor. The assignment for you is to promise me in the next couple days that you go up to somebody that you don't know.
Yeah, well, sure. Well, if you have a
Introduce yourself as somebody who is an immigrant or who supports immigrants, and engage them in a conversation about how and why immigrants are contributors to our society, both socially and economically. Because understand this, the United States is an experiment. It's an experiment that is unfinished. It's unfinished because constantly we are a nation of immigrants. And as new immigrants come in, the experiment changes. So we need to keep informing everyone that the experience is a positive one. And we do that by introducing ourselves to those who we don't know and letting them know how we feel in a calm manner that reasons with them so that they get to know us and they get to love us. Thank you. Congratulations. Thank you very much, Professor Hain. Okay, we also want to have Supervisor Jane Kim is here joining us today. She was one of the co-sponsors for today's.
Awesome to follow one of our revered professors, Commissioner Bill Ocking. So I will try to follow up to him. But it's really great to be on a board where actually I believe the majority of our membership were raised in immigrant families. And so it's important for us to recognize our immigrant communities and everything that they have done to really build this country. This country is a country of immigrants. And when we look at how our economy was built, how our infrastructure is built, who creates our jobs, who does the work to make our community a safer and stronger and healthier place to be, it has always been in our immigrant community. And so I'm really excited to be here today to support Immigrant Family Month. This is also me supporting my parents for their contributions, for getting me to this place. We all recognize that even getting our members of our community to elected office happened through decades of community activism and history, and I owe that to so many activists and leaders that come before me. So thank you. It's an honor to be here today.
Thank you very much, Supervisor Kim, Representative District 6, the South of Market, many Filipinos, Arabic, Latino community members. Next, I want to invite up a staff member of Supervisor Malia Cohen's office for District 6.
Only to Benio, I'm legislative aide, Supervisor Cohen. Supervisor Cohen couldn't be here, but she did want to show her support for Immigrant Family Month and all of you wonderful people here. Thank you for being here. So, as we know, immigrants in the, have built this city. They've really built the nation, from the Statue of Liberty to the Golden Gate Bridge. My father's an immigrant. I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for him. Similar things that you all have done to bring yourself to the point that you are at today. So I really just wanted to be here to show the supervisor support, and she really apologized that she was not able to make it today. So thank you all for being here. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We look forward to her support on the vote today of the resolution. Next, we want to bring up, thank you all, the supervisor, Professor Hing. As we mentioned earlier, today we are releasing a report, SF Island's report from the Immigrant Integration Project, which many of you participated in. To talk about the project, we'd like to call on Annette Wong. She's the program coordinator for SF Island. I also want to recognize, I saw him here a minute ago, Gen Fujioka, used to be with the Asian Law Caucus, and Eric Quesada, who passed away, used to be with the Lower Street Community Service. So I want to acknowledge those two for helping to start SF Island. for them joining us today and for Eric for all of his work. But first, you know, before we talk about the report, can we get a round of applause for Annette Wong? Annette, for all of her hard work, patience, and commitment she brings to the network. She's the coordinator of the whole San Francisco Immigrant Legal and Education Network, 13 organizations. She truly is the glue that holds us together as a network, and we want to thank her for all of her work. Today's a perfect day to show our appreciation for all that she does as a coordinator. So again, a big round of applause for Annette Wong.
San Francisco Immigrant Integration Project, as Terry mentioned, many of you took part in it. We're very excited to release the results today. Back in 2010, Eric Quezada, Terry just mentioned a while ago, had the vision to start this project where we would use community-based research to assess the community members' knowledge of and access to critical services needed to community gatherings, to get people's feedback on how they're doing in the city of San Francisco as immigrants. One of the more groundbreaking aspects of this research project in particular is that over 20% of the respondents on our survey identified as undocumented, and that really goes to show the trust and relationship of our SF Island partner organizations with community members. So before I talk a little bit more about the findings, we just really want to thank the Mayor's Office of Housing and Community Development, the San Francisco Foundation, the University of San Francisco Leo T. McCarthy Center for Public Service and the Common Good, our consultant Maria Rogers as well, Grace Lee, CAA, for writing our report, and all of our SF Island staff, and most importantly, all the community members who took part in the project. We're very, very grateful, and also for the Office of Civic Engagement and Immigrant Affairs and the Immigrant Rights Commission for endorsing and supporting our project. So let's get to the findings. In general, the people who took the survey felt welcome in the city of San Francisco. But when we asked them whether or not key needs were being met, the results painted a very different picture. Participants listed housing, employment, and health care as the top three necessities to live a good quality of life. And for nearly two-thirds of the people participating in the survey, their health care needs were being fulfilled, so that's a great finding. However, around housing and employment, these were far from being met. In terms of housing, 48% of immigrants surveyed are struggling to have their housing needs met, and 58% of immigrants surveyed have difficulty accessing affordable housing services. Additionally, many respondents noted that unscrupulous landlords provide uninhabitable living spaces for really, really high rent prices. And the housing crisis, as we know, is only exacerbating these problems. In terms of employment, 45% of respondents do not have the job training, employment assistance, or worker rights assistance that they need. And immigrant workers are chronically underemployed, often working multiple part-time jobs, and vulnerable to workplace discrimination and exploitation in unregulated industries. Language barriers and difficulty locating services were also noted as reasons for the high percentage of folks having difficulty in terms of employment, which clearly points to the need for more culturally and linguistically appropriate services to help our community members. A recent study by the University of Southern California Center for the Study of Immigrant Integration found very similar results. In the study, San Francisco ranked number one in terms of welcoming messages, but ranked dead last in terms of economic mobility for immigrants. It's a very surprising finding, but it only goes to show that we have a lot of work to do in the city in terms of immigrant integration, and with all of our people power here, I'm sure that we can do that. So thank you so much.
Project was truly a community-led process, and to talk
talk more about this, we want to invite Union, a member of one of our really loved organizations, CAA, who will talk to us about her work in the San Francisco Immigrant Integration Project and her leadership and how that made such a key and important contribution to advancing this report. So let's give it up for Union. There are male, females, and immigrants who have immigrated to the States for a year or 10 years or even 20 years.
Mario De Mira from the Filipino Community Center.
Good
afternoon, everyone. Good morning to all of you. Congratulations and happy Immigrant Family Day. For the past 4 years, 5 years, I've been coming to Immigrant Family Day, and I've been getting these wonderful shirts. So I have everyone in blue, green, yellow, now red. So it's a wonderful thing. But as Terry mentioned, you know, immigrant families are really struggling in our city. As people recognize San Francisco as a global city and are drawn in to come and live here and appreciate the great things about this city, our folks, our immigrant communities are being pushed out. And our folks are having challenges accessing jobs and access to employment and their workers' rights as well. One of the big things that we see in a lot of our immigrant communities is the issues of workers' rights. In the Chinese community in Chinatown, there was a report done that nearly 50% of restaurant workers were not being paid the minimum wage. In the Latino community, day laborers and domestic workers face massive amounts of wage theft and other violations to their rights. In the Filipino community, a lot of Filipino caregivers who do the important work of caring for our elderly and for our sick are not paid basic minimum wage and also are not paid for all the hours that they work. So we see that there are so many barricades in front of our communities for them to flourish in this life here in San Francisco. The Filipino Community Center, in the last 2 years, we've been able to win back over $1.5 million in wages, in lost and stolen wages. Our community partners in the Workers' Rights Collaborative here in San Francisco have done even more, and I don't have the exact numbers, but it's in the millions of being able to get back these stolen wages. And I'm telling you this because we all know that our immigrant communities are really vulnerable to this kind of exploitation. And we, not just as a community, but as a city, need to do more to improve these conditions and to fight this kind of exploitation. Moving forward, we're going to be proposing a minimum wage ordinance that will help increase the minimum wage for our workers here in San Francisco, for all workers and immigrant workers to have a good living wage so they can sustain, so they're not pushed out of the city, so they're not victimized by gentrification. And we all need to do it together. And lastly, and I really wish one of our members could have been here to really talk about it, but he had to work, but we had a discussion about Immigrant Family Day, and we had a discussion about the situation of immigrants in our city, and we all kind of recognized that, yes, San Francisco has great standards. We have high standards for the immigrant community. We have workers' rights standards. We are a sanctuary city. But was that given to us? Was that given to us? Did it fall on our laps? No, we fought for it as a community, and we must continue as a community to fight for these rights that we deserve. So thank you very much. Looking forward to seeing you guys in the City Hall and in the street.
Once again, let's give it up for Mario de Mira with FCC. People getting tired. We can do a chant. We'll do a chant right now for closing. So next up, we wanna bring up Wendy, a member of Causa Justa, to talk to us about her story around housing issues. As we know and as we heard Annette mention, housing is a critical issue for immigrants, for all people in the city, and in particular for immigrants. The conditions are often deplorable. The prices and the exploitation that happens of immigrant tenants, it's really an issue that needs to be addressed, and that, as Mario mentioned, right, all these rights and protections that tenants have not fallen on our laps. All the protections that we have as workers have not fallen on our laps. We have fought hard, and we need to continue to fight hard to make housing and jobs really jobs that will pay living wages and housing that is dignified and that is habitable and that is affordable. And so I want to bring up Wendy, who's going to share with us her story. Wendy, give it up for Wendy.
Buenas tardes, mi nombre es Wendy Oliva, actualmente soy miembro de Causa Justa. Yo estoy aquí presente para invitar a la comunidad de diferentes países, no solo los latinos, a que aprendamos lo que son nuestros derechos, a defender lo que son nuestros derechos en cuanto a vivienda, en cuanto a salud, en cuanto a un empleo. Donde nos toque defender, no hay que agachar la cabeza, hay que buscar organizaciones. En este momento yo le doy gracias a Dios primeramente por haber puesto en mi camino lo que son las puertas de Causa Justa, al personal que con una pareja. Ellos son los inquilinos principales. Estas personas me están desalojando a mis dos hijos y a mi pareja. Ellos nos han desalojado con algo injusto, algo que no es real. Al momento antes yo no sabía cuáles eran mis derechos. Yo pagaba la renta, se las pagaba cash, nunca me daban un recibo. Yo no sabía que es un derecho que toda persona tiene en cualquier parte donde uno vive. Aparte de eso, como yo interpuse, fui a pedir ayuda a Causa Justa, interpusimos una demanda defendiendo nuestros derechos. Ellos han negado, se han apoyado en cosas ilegales, me han llevado a corte, me pusieron orden de restricción. He pasado tantas cosas que yo le digo a la comunidad, no nos demos por vencidos, luchemos por nuestros derechos, hagámonos y demostremos de que tenemos dignidad. A mí siempre ellos se me dicen, tú no tienes dignidad, si te corriera sangre por tu cara te fueras. Mi respuesta es, sí tengo dignidad, sí tengo, y me corre sangre por mi cara y por todo mi cuerpo, y por ello estoy luchando aquí. Entonces yo invito a la comunidad a que por favor sigamos adelante, busquemos siempre una organización, un apoyo, que siempre hay puertas que se abren, siempre hay organizaciones como lo es Causa Justa, Carecen, otras instituciones donde uno puede tocar una puerta y sabemos que se nos va a abrir. La vivienda es un derecho y es un derecho a que tengamos una vivienda segura, no con hostigamiento de ningún tipo. Tenemos muchos derechos, busquemos información para que nos apoyemos en ellos. Gracias.
So my name is Wendy and I'm a member of Just Cause. I'm here to tell all community members, all different immigrant community members, to defend and stand up for your rights, to not take on the abuses that may happen to you in your housing situation, that you have to stand up and defend your rights. I want our communities to understand how important it is to really organize ourselves, to seek organization, and to fight back against the abuses. We all know that it's hard to find housing where we can afford the rent, because the rents are so high in San Francisco. We are in a housing crisis, and owners are taking advantage and abusing of tenants. The fact that these abuses are happening puts so many of our families at risk. My family is currently at risk of losing their housing. Myself, my two children, and my partner are at risk of losing our housing. We stay in one small in an apartment with master tenants. Where I live, the person in charge, or the master tenant, has been harassing me and my family to get out of the unit. We've been confronted by so much harassment and violence and different attempts to illegally evict us. I didn't know what my rights were, and so once I came to CJJC and I learned about my rights, I knew that I wasn't doing anything wrong and that I needed to start asking for receipts when I pay my rent. When they tried to illegally evict us, they started making up things about us, saying that we weren't paying rent. And once I was at CJJC, I knew that I needed to start taking my receipts. I needed to make sure that I wasn't paying more than my share of housing, and that my housing, I was able to stay there without being harassed and without threats of eviction. Many people don't know that they have rights, and we suffer in silence the harassment that other landlords and master tenants do to us. And that's why I'm saying that it is so important to seek help, to organize ourselves, and to fight for our right to just housing and dignified housing for our families. Housing is a human right. La lucha sigue. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you so much, Wendy from Causa Justa. What folks have been talking about, all of the work and the rights that they are fighting for at their workplaces, in their homes, all of these things are highlighted in the Immigrant Integration Project report. But at the core of our work at SF Island, it's the immigration services that we're able to provide. So next we want to bring up a speaker, a community member who was a client of both the Asian Pacific Islander Legal Outreach of APILO.
Vine a este país a trabajar tengo 22 años. Trabajo, estaba recién venido a El Salvador y encontré un trabajo para cuidar una parejita de ancianos. Y trabajé los 20 años con ellos, pero fallecieron hace 2 años. Y bueno, yo ahí sufrí mucho porque estaba encerrada. Todos mis 20 años que pasé ahí con ellos fue de estar encerrada, no tenía salida, no tenía no tenía días de descanso. Trabajaba de día y de noche, las 24 horas, y luego me llevaban a un rancho a trabajar allá por 3 días con la señora y una de sus hijas, y luego regresábamos siempre lo mismo a la casa. Y el salario que me daban era bien poquito. Primero me empezaron a pagar $400, luego me aumentaron a 500, y pues así pasé los 20 años. Y luego yo salí de ahí, no podía yo comunicarme con la gente porque no conocía casi la gente, porque casi como no, ahí con ellos no tenía salida. Y no, también yo me encontraba bien difícil para salir sola. No podía agarrar el bus para salir al centro, pero encontré una persona que se llama Silvia, Silde, y ella pues me recomendó a Mujeres Unidas, y ahí estoy y me siento bien. Ya siempre estoy los miércoles. Eso me ha ayudado mucho porque ahí ya yo empecé a salir y ya agarro el bus. El bus me lleva a una dirección que es Las Estrellas, es lo único que he podido agarrar la dirección bien, y para llegar a Mujeres Unidas. Y así es que, y también ha ido a Los Ángeles, agarré el bus que va para Los Ángeles. Cuando yo antes pues no podía salir, no tenía salida, pero ahora sí, me siento bien, porque allí Mujeres Unidas me han ayudado mucho. Y pues por ahorita me siento bien. Y también he ido a Sacramento, a las marchas, a apoyar a la Carta de las Mujeres Trabajadoras del Hogar. Y es esto. Gracias.
For health care for all, for worker rights protections, for a living wage in this city. Give it up. And to really close off, we're going to do our chant again. Are you ready for it?
So if folks can gather up here around the podium, Cynthia and I will go down there and hold up the signs, and you all come together for a picture around the podium. So stand here next to the podium, and then we'll do this chant together. Afterwards, we're going to go inside, back inside for lunch at Southlight Court, and then at 2 o'clock, we're going to go to the Board of Supervisors meeting at 2 o'clock on the second floor. So we'll have to go through the security again, everybody, but after we do this chant, we'll go in and have lunch together in the Southlight Court.
So we're going to hold this up and we're going to say Yan Man Na Tun Vit La, and then you say what I hold up, okay?
So we say this,
you're all responsible.